back there jamming with us, y'all.
You guys remember all those songs? Yeah. All of them? Yeah. All of them?
Yeah. I think they love them.
Thank you. this is serious stuff. This is, obviously it's Valentine's Day, so happy Valentine's to every one of you. This is the last show of our tour. Know if tour is the right word or what, but what we did after we found out the horrible news, just like you guys did. Hang on a second, let me finish talking and then whoop and holler all you want. We tried to figure out the best way to deal with this, right? And it was really complicated. It's not as easy as you think, being the revolution. It's not that easy. We gravitated to each other when he died, and we didn't know what to do with our grief, just like you guys didn't know what to do with your grief. The only way we knew how to conjure any kind of good feeling was to play music together. It was a rough go at first, but you know, we've gotten through a couple stages of this grief process, which has been, for anyone who's lost people in their lives, obviously you guys have, but this was a complicated one. They're all complicated, I don't mean to, anyway. So, we only could do this. We didn't know what it was called, or we reuniting. No, not reuniting. We never were apart. Are we going out to, like, do something that was beyond our means? We were very conscious of not doing anything that was beyond us, that needed to stay in the realm of the mindfulness that we were approaching all of this for you guys and for us. When you come to a show, when you come and listen to live music, when you go and see art, when you go to a play, when you involve yourself and embed yourself in an experience, you become your best self, even if there's tears involved, right? Even if there's tears, you are your true self. Yeah. And that's what we wanted to do in this room with everybody, is to become our best selves, whether it was tears or whether it was laughter, hopefully it's a combo of both, and try and get through this crazy thing called life. Now, what is really important to know that we kept in mind is that you guys represent Uptown. You represent Paisley Park. Everything that he wrote and everything that we did together in our little world was for and about you guys and trying to conjure this feeling. So, I just want to give you a little bit of background on how this came about. I promise, Bobby, I won't take too long. Mark, I won't. we were all the magic age of 19 when each of us collectively were culled from him. When I was the last person to join the revolution, he said to Bobby, he'd finally found, don't laugh, I think it's actually beautiful, that he found his Fleetwood Mac. And then he'd say it to someone else and say, he found his Silver Stone. So depending on who it was, he'd say that too. Bobby's been here the longest. He knew him when he was just a kid. I know that sounds really old. It is really old. Then Matt came along afterwards and heard they were friends in Minneapolis, and in an area of Minneapolis called St. Louis Park, where the Coen brothers are also from and Bob Dylan are from, and they called it St. Jewish Park. And they knew each other, and they went to, you know, the same hangouts and heard Bobby had gotten into this band with Prince, and he had heard a tape, and he was like, oh my God, I want to be, what's that band? I want to be in that band. And Bobby was like, it's not a band, it's a guy. And Beth started, it didn't matter to him, he wanted to be in that band. Right? Is that correct? Right. And then came Darling Lisa. She's a hippie chick from Hollywood. Was the only import at the time, and got a call from Prince's management company at the time that was trying to find a girl keyboard player. This is 1979? Oh, Christ. 1979. I was still in high school. Anyway. She got called out. He picked her up at the airport, Minneapolis airport, his little Fiat. And drove her back to his house in Chanhassen. No, it wasn't in Chanhassen. Where was it at the time? Where was he living?
Mound.
Oh, right.
Edina.
Was he in Edina?
Orno.
Oh, Orno.
Lake Riley. Okay. For those who didn't know.
I don't remember.
Whatever.
10,000 lights.
Lake Zachary. Whatever. Pick one. So, she gets in the car in the Fiat, and oh my God, she's like, do you mind if I smoke a cigarette? And he's like, no. And she lights up a cigarette in the car, and then they're both very quiet people. They can barely speak the English language. So they're driving in this car, and the windows are smoking, picking up this hippie chick from Hollywood. They get back to his house, and he opens the door, and he says, the piano's downstairs. And she didn't know it at the time. But he was on the phone with his management company upstairs, and he's like, I don't think this is going to work. And then he said, hang on a minute. And he heard her playing like what you just heard a couple minutes ago. And he said, never mind. But he had a girlfriend at the time, Kim Upshur, who has since passed away. But he had a girlfriend at the time. Kim had known Mark. And Mark, Prince was looking for a bass player at the time, so Mark was working at a pancake house. So for those of you who think that you're below a pancake house, look where you can go. He was 19 as well. All of us were 19. Kim took Prince to go get some pancakes at the pancake house, and Mark made him a stack of pancakes. And hired him on the spot. He was 19 years old. I came a couple of years later. I saw him. I grew up with this one over here. And I saw him from a distance doing the video for Sexuality. And I saw him from here to the back of the room, and I was like, what's that thing? What is that thing over there? It changed my life forever. It changed my life forever. Hearing him, seeing him, experiencing him. I was very quiet as a kid. I had fallen in love with this man. I didn't know what I was doing. I was this crazy young person who didn't, I mean, was I gay, straight, Black, white, Puerto Rican, everybody just a freak. And I was all of that. I was all of that. And he asked Lisa, you know, after he'd heard me practicing guitar, he asked Lisa, how do you feel if I ask if your girlfriend joins the band? And she's like, thumbs up. How lucky. I was 19. Okay, so after he died, us 50-something-year-olds decided we needed to do something about this. So we thought, okay, let's create some kind of playlist where we can get everybody else to be, because we get the inevitable question, who's going to sing? Are you going to get Beyonce to be your lead vocalist? That'll be cool. Hang on a minute. It's not what this is about. This is just a scrappy bunch of musicians that are coming out here to try and, like, raise some smoke signals and had everybody involved. So we tried to put a set list together that was the first step in the healing process. We didn't, for those of you who are wondering why we didn't go to deeper cuts, why we're not doing Girls and Boys or Love or Money or some weird cuts from Crystal Ball or the Dream Factory, that'll come. That'll come. Right now, this is like, this moment for us and for you guys is about hearing these songs and what it was like for everybody the first time they heard these songs and they had to inhale. You had to inhale because it was overwhelming to hear this, right? That's what we wanted to come out with. Now, here's where we're at. We did want someone to come out here and be a part of this. And there was a guy in Minneapolis that Prince adored. That's Stokely. And he's been around for a while. He's a staple in the Minneapolis community. He's made many records with his band, Mint Condition, records on his own. But Prince gravitated to this guy. And we thought, what a perfect person, because Stokely. He's not doing Prince, he's doing Stokely. And that's the energy that needed to be. There's just a perfect combination for all of us to do this. Now, this is where we're at. Yeah. You guys have to be the lead vocalists now. It's not about us doing it. Like, oh, they did it. Oh my God, that Darling Nikki never sounded better. Not gonna happen. You guys are gonna sing it, and you're gonna close your eyes, and you're gonna become it. You're gonna feel what it was like. You're gonna make this stuff live forever. And we're gonna play it while we're still alive, so that you guys can hear what it felt like when we did it. And it becomes a bigger experience. Okay, so we're going to close this out tonight, and we're going to do Purple Rain now. Don't spoil the word. And you have to sing every word of it. I'll sit back, we'll also mouth it, be a bouncing ball, but you guys have to sing every word, and you need to raise the roof, right?